Hey, Buff Nation, Voice of the Boss, Mark Johnson here. Coming up this week in the Buffalo Stampede. Tough loss for the Colorado football team. We're going to recap a loss to Stanford with Coach Gary Barnett, sideline reporter Andy Lindahl, plus basketball just around the corner. A lot of excitement on the hardwood. We're going to talk with head coaches J.R. Payne and Tad Boyle all this week in the Buffalo Stampede. On third down, sets, throws, a crossing pattern caught by Travis Hunter, spins away from defender, to the 10-yard line, to the 5, to the end zone. I'm telling you, he is not human. He's from another world. Travis Hunter, after missing 3 games, he caught it on a crossing pattern. He spun a man into the ground and then took it to the end zone of 24 yards.
Well, it was great to see Travis Hunter back in the field after missing 3 games, playing both sides of the ball. There he scores his first career touchdown as a Colorado Buffalo. Ended up going over 100 yards, rather, with 2 touchdowns. Hi, everybody. Buffalo Stampede, voice of the bus, Mark Johnson, Coach Gary Barnett. But what a turnaround of that ball game. Colorado went 29-0 at the half, end up losing in overtime, 46-43, losing a 29-point lead. What do you say after a ball game like that when you stand in front of your team?
Well, first of all, you got to be real careful because you can't lose it. You know, you've got to have time to filter this, and you've got to have time to think about this and process it. Nobody could feel any worse than they do, except maybe you as a coach, and your coaches, because it always means more to the coaches than it does the players. I don't care what level it is, and so. So but I think you're measured. You need time before you can really sit down and talk about this thing. You let them know that this comes with a territory. You know, as many people as that cheered you out there and your pictures everywhere, guess what? They're gonna question everything you did and wonder why, and all of a sudden you're not gonna be the guy they thought you were. So you gotta live with that too. It comes with the territory.
Gary, it was really 2 different halves here. Colorado dominating in the first half. They came out with a bare defense that was dominating. Then everything changed in the second half. Really interesting how you've got that disparity.
I don't think I've ever seen 2 completely different halves in a football game like I've seen in this one. Right. And for whatever reason, both teams changed. You know, Stanford quit doing what they were doing on defense.
They were dropping 8 the first
half. Stopped that, started bringing pressure like everybody else has throughout the year. We were playing a very aggressive defense in the first half. We didn't play it in the second half. I think, Mark, that 97-yard touchdown, to me, when I watched that, I just saw air go out of our building.
Yeah.
And I'm sure off of that sideline as well.
Yeah, 97-yard touchdown by Alec Iomanner, and he was dominant. Nearly 300 yards receiving in the ball game. Couldn't cover him. After this ball game, when Colorado loses a 29-point lead, we hear from head coach Deion Sanders.
Presented by Coors Light. Coors Light, mountain cold refreshment made to chill. Celebrate responsibly.
Just in how I felt going in at halftime. We come back out, and here comes the complacency. Here comes that team that I can't stand, that you can't stand, that you can't understand how in the world that happens to us. But it did. Didn't turn it back on, I think, until late in the fourth quarter when we were able to go down and get a score. And we go down, and then they tied up, and we got overtime. And you don't want to go in overtime because they have nothing to lose. I was surprised that they kicked the field goal the first time. I thought they was just going to go for 2 and try the best to get it over with. But they were resilient. Big win by them. Horrible loss by us. We didn't play well, not just Travis. I think it all started when we gave up on the 97-yard touchdown. Our secondary did not play the best game, especially at the cornerback position. We're not built for the moment. Some of our players aren't built for the moment where they have to make a play, or they have to keep contained, or they have to make a block, or they have to get another yard. We're not built for the moment right now.
Now, some very honest comments from Coach Prime after the ball game. Bus falling double overtime. We continue with Coach Gary Barnett. You said that that's one thing about Coach Prime that you appreciate, his honesty and frankness, the way he handled himself in these tough situations.
Yeah, and you know, he's really eloquent. He really says what needs to be said at the time, and And all coaches want to do that.
Yeah.
We're maybe not as good as maybe Coach Sanders is doing it, but it's hard. You know, it's just, I hate to keep saying it comes with the territory, but when you sign up to be a coach, that's what you sign up for. Those are your kids. And you've got to get them through this, okay? And yelling at them doesn't get them through it. You've got to get through it, and you've got to handle it the right way. And so, you know, he's got his work cut out for him, he and his coaches. The hardest thing really is going to be his discussions with his coaches.
Yeah.
They're grown men. He's not responsible.
Going to be very honest there.
He's going to be very honest. Yeah.
The Buffaloes had two receivers over 100 yards. Xavier Weaver, who's been so solid during his tenure here for the Buffaloes. Travis Hunter, also over 100 yards. First time in Colorado history, two receivers over 100 yards, each with two touchdowns. Travis went out there, and that was a tough matchup for him tonight on Iowa Manor. I mean, that was a premier matchup of two high-level players. That was a very tough, difficult cover for him.
It was, and, you know, the interesting thing to me is they weren't afraid to go after Travis Hunter.
Yeah.
You know, he caught, what, how many balls? 13 for 294 yards.
Yeah.
Not all of them on Travis.
Right.
But they had no hesitancy throwing that ball in his direction with Travis on it.
All right. They say there is a good time for a bye week. There's a bad time for a bye week. Coming off this ball game, you think this is a bad time?
I wouldn't like it. You know, you need to get this taste out of your mouth. And to sit there and gnaw on it and chew on it for 2 weeks, I'm telling you, it drives you nuts.
Yeah.
And especially if you don't know your kids. And there's no way for Coach Sanders to know these kids the way he would if he'd recruited them all, brought them here, been with them for a couple of years. He's been with them for, what, months?
Yeah.
So if you don't know them, then you don't know what to expect, and you're not quite sure how to deal with them. And so you just have to wing it and do as best as you can.
Yeah, with the bye week, now you got to suck on this bitter pill for 2 weeks. They play in 2 weeks at UCLA in the Rose Bowl. Still don't have a game time on that one. Colorado falls in double overtime, 46-43. We'll talk with our Saturday reporter, Andy Lindahl, coming up next.
Shotgun snap taken by Shadur, takes the handoff, throws this one end zone. Touchdown! Touchdown, Colorado! X marks the spot. Xavier Weaver with the lightning bolt thrown by Shadur Sanders. A touchdown of 9 yards.
Snap, takes the handoff, drops, scans, looks, goes for the home run. Down the right side, Xavier Weaver's out there. Makes the grab at the 18-yard line. Slides down, tapped down defensively by the cornerback. Shadur stands out of the shotgun, takes a snap, runs the option on the pitch on a reverse. Xavier Weaver, he's going to waltz in like a walk in the park on a Sunday.
Now, Xavier Weaver's been so good all season long. He ends up over 100 yards receiving, two receiving touchdowns, and that rushing touchdown when he waltzed in as well. Back in the Buffalo Stampede, voice of the Bus, Mark Johnson, Andy Lindahl, our sideline reporter. Bus falling double overtime, giving up a 29-0 lead. Tale of two halves. What was that like down there on the sideline as that thing was getting away from Colorado?
Well, and look, Coach Barnett said it during the broadcast when we wrapped up. I was impressed with Coach Prime as well because he was right. You could feel, you could just kind of feel, we've kind of got this one, okay? That's what it felt like. I just think he had a good read from the crowd, look, to the broadcast crew.
Right.
You know, this just felt like one of their best performances they had, and then all of a sudden it wasn't. And you know, it was crazy because Coach talked about the quick slant that led to the 97-yard touchdown.
That's
or
right.
Whatever that ended up being. And you didn't think too much of it at the time, but you and I have watched a lot of football. In the back of my head, I thought to myself, well, I hope that's not the switch for Stanford. But here we are. You know, this was one where Coach talks about it all the time. You've got to be able to run the football when you want to run the football, and this team is still trying to find that gene in their game.
Well, you go back to the second overtime. Colorado gets the penalty against Stanford, has it first and goal from the two, and you want to just poke it in and then put the pressure back on Stanford, and you can't get 2 yards.
Yeah, and it was tough. And Hankerson, he had a full head of steam. And credit the Stanford tacklers. Not only did they get in at his feet, they pulled him back. They did a great job. I was right there in the end zone where it happened. They are a good tackling team. Mm-hmm. It's a disappointing night. I'm not sure Travis Hunter was right after that big touchdown. You guys are asking for a big play in the booth. Travis comes up with it, but then takes a wicked shot in the process. And I just felt like I saw Travis kind of favoring the side a little bit. Now, I'm sure he was tired, too.
A little bit of wincing going on.
He just wasn't I don't think he was quite himself after that.
Right.
And he still played really well, but man, it's just one of those nights, and it's unfortunate it was one of those nights.
So the Buffaloes end up dropping this ball game against the Stanford Cardinal in double overtime, 46-43, and afterward we heard from the quarterback, Shedeur Sanders.
Powered by Ford, cars, trucks, and SUVs built for America, built Ford proud.
Really understand, like, we got to be the same way, same approach, same everything. It's the difference with saying that, and it's the difference with meaning and going about it. Each and everything. So it was definitely frustrating because, like I say, it was one or two players away from really hitting explosive plays, from doing the right things each and every drive we had. So, like, when we look at the film and what I noticed on the field, it was just all 11 players got to do their job, and that's it. We can't, because the stuff going to catch up when it catch up, and it caught up to us today. I'm mainly focused on the team and focused on what we need to improve on, and the people gonna hate you and love you, so you gotta understand that's what you can't be happy when everything's good and sad when everything's bad. You gotta be the same person regardless. So that's basically where I just stay and how I live my life, is just level headed throughout the whole game, staying the same way, not getting too up, not getting too down, because as you've seen, things could go left quick, and today's a moment to show that live in person.
Now there's QB1 after the ball game. He threw for 400 yards and 5 touchdowns. Did have the one interception, though, in the second overtime that really cost the Buffaloes. End up falling because Stanford then comes back and kicks the field goal to win it 46-43. We continue with Andy Lindell. Now you got to sit there in the stink, if you will, for a couple of weeks, huh?
Yeah,
that's not easy.
Again, Coach Prime letting us know he wishes they could go ahead and play right away,
yeah.
Which, look, sometimes that works to your advantage, sometimes it doesn't. I don't think these kids are going to enjoy that they have 2 weeks off. I think they're going to get back to some old school kind of stuff. But look, at the end of the day, the players you have are the players that you have, and they brought in a lot of exciting players. But, you know, fundamentally, some stuff's got to get done with the blocking and the run game. We've talked a lot about that. And hopefully this 2 weeks will give them a chance to maybe scheme up some more pass rush at times. But, you know, these young men, they've had a lot of fun. They've had a lot of attention.
A lot of hype.
The sunglasses, the whole deal. I think Coach Prime, from what we heard in the post-game press conference, is going to make this 2 weeks of work again. It may feel like the start of summer camp.
Well, now here's where you sit for Colorado. You get this one, which everyone thought you would. You're a heavy favorite in this ball game. You're 5-2 going into a bye. You need one more to get bowl eligible. Now you're sitting at 4-3, right? 1-3 in Pac-12 conference play. UCLA, Oregon State, Utah's in there. Washington State, Arizona's better than people want to talk about. Now you look at this thing and go, boy, you've got some tough, tough games coming up here. Where do you find the wins?
Yeah, and just this is so tough because it was a home game.
Mm-hmm.
And this was one of the games where you were actually thought to be the better team, and
yep,
for a half you showed it. Now you got to steal one back. You know, that's what's going to be hard. And it's probably going to have to be on the road. You're going to have to handle business at home against Arizona. But that was going to be the case anyway. You're going to have to get one back. But, you know, look, this team has surprised us before.
Yep.
They've responded in big moments. Even though it wasn't a win, they responded against USC when they'd had the tough loss against Oregon. Let's see what they do against UCLA in 2 weeks.
Well, the Buffaloes will face the Bruins at the Rose Bowl in a couple of weeks. Still don't have a time on that one. We will next week. We'll find out when the Buffs and the Bruins will play. But a disappointing loss as the Buffs cop up a 29-point lead and the falling in double overtime. That's our Sotland reporter, Andy Lindell. When we come back here to Buffalo Stampede, basketball season right around the corner. We're talking hoops.
I can't believe it's year 14, but here we are. I'm as excited as ever about being the head coach at the University of Colorado. I'm as excited as ever about the team we have coming back. And I think we've got a great combination of veterans who have kind of been there, done that, and have been through the wars, so to speak. And we've got some really good newcomers, some good young talent in the program. So I think that how we blend, you know, the old with the new, certainly over the first, you know, month or two of the season, is going to be critical in our success this year. But I like the track we're on. They're a coachable group. They work hard. They're competitive. And once we get all hands on deck, which we're not quite there yet, I like its ceiling. It's pretty darn high. So the league is going to be good. as it always is. I think this year there's a lot of good teams in the Pac-12, a lot of good talent, a lot of good big guys. So it's going to be a fun year.
Well, there's head coach of the Buffaloes, Tad Boyle, his opening statement for Media Day, which means that basketball is just around the corner. Back in the Stampede, voice of the Bus, Mark Johnson. And we couldn't get enough of him. We asked him to come in and do a little stand-up with us. All right. A couple weeks in, you having fun?
I am, yeah. This is a fun group to coach, really competitive group, and they're coachable, learning a lot. And we got, you know, some really young, talented guys, which is always exciting. But we're really I'm leaning on those veterans, the Tristan Da Silvas, the Luke O'Briens, and KJ and Julian and Javon Hadley. Those guys I'm leaning on every single day.
That's got to be, just those guys you mentioned right there, a little bit of a security blanket, I would think, because they've seen so much basketball and they've got your trust, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I've got theirs, they got mine. And but listen, we're going to need some of these young guys to step up and be contributors this year. And the sooner the better. It's just, again, it's their heads are spinning right now. We're only, 16 practices in.
During your tenure here, you've had some great, great players. Tristan falls into that category. And every one of those guys, by the time they become a senior, junior, their last year, they carry themselves different. He's got that swag right now, if you will.
No doubt. Yeah, I think he and Luke both do. They know they're seniors. They know they're going to have good years. They've got confidence. But Tristan especially has got he's just got a way about him right now where you just know, okay, when it's time for us to make a play, I'm going to be a part of it. And whether it's getting a bucket or distributing for a teammate or whatever the case may be, he's grown by leaps and bounds since the end of last year.
Ted, when you've got a guy like Cody Williams who gets obviously as much pub as he does because he's a highly, highly regarded young man, top five recruit in the country, sometimes when you bring a guy like that in, they can get overwhelmed. I would imagine it helps when you've got a Tristan Da Silva, who we know is going to be the cornerstone, a KJ who's been. That takes some pressure off the young guy, doesn't it?
It does. And I think the beauty about Cody is I think he's willing to learn from KJ and Tristan, those vets. But they're willing to help him. Yeah. And they've done a great job of that. And he's really taken to that. He's a very humble young man. He's hungry to learn. And he's going to have a great, great freshman year.
You got a chance to coach him during the under-19 summer Olympic stuff. What have you learned about him as a player in the period of time you've been with him?
What I've learned about Cody is he gets better, and he doesn't make the same mistake twice. What he does is he listens, he learns, he comes in to watch film on his own, and he's really an intelligent player. So that's going to really serve him well. You know, as he hits those bumps in the road, he'll work through them.
A lot of talent on this basketball team in year 14 for Tad Boyle, including the point guard, KJ Simpson. Well, you're getting to be an old man with the team now. You've been around for a long time, kind of a veteran. With that comes experience, but also a lot of expectation, right?
Yeah, for sure. I'm definitely getting up there in age. I'm excited. You know, like you said, with that comes experience. And, you know, these young guys are looking up to me to be the leader that, you know, I was looking up to Evan and Eli, those guys, to be for me. So it's just all full circle.
So do you try in practice? I mean, we talked to Cody, and he said, you know, some of the older guys sometimes yelling at me. Mm-hmm. That's coaching.
Yeah.
Are you going out day in and day in practice trying to help them, trying to lift them up, trying to make sure they understand? Because the better they are, the better you guys
are. Exactly.
Be, right?
That's the only way we're going to be better as a team. Those guys, you know, although they're freshmen, they have a really, really important role, or else they wouldn't be here. Mm-hmm. They wouldn't be playing with us. And so just like how it was my freshman year, you know, guys got on you, but you have to learn this because they care about you, because they love you. They want to see you get better, which makes the team better. So, and I think all the young guys kind of have a sense for that, and they appreciate it. So, yeah.
All right, being a point guard, point guards become great coaches. Mm-hmm. I want you to give me your coaching scouting report of this young group of players you've got. There's some talent there, isn't there?
There is a lot of talent. I mean, you can start with Cody. I mean, obviously, everything that's advertised about him is true. I mean, he's a really, really special talent, but he's really humble and unselfish. So he's not just going out looking to score. You know, he's going to make winning plays. And then you have Hassan and BD, you got a big post presence. Mm-hmm. Hassan can really stretch the floor, even BD, but BD is really good at blocking shots. Hassan's an excellent rebounder, and he loves, you know, talking, uses his voice on the floor. And then you have Courtney. You know, Courtney coming in, really, really long, lengthy guard, kind of like Cody. He really digs deep, and defense kind of gets in you or makes it a little frustrating, but now that's what you want. You want somebody like that on your team, and a great shooter, great mid-range shooter, loves attacking the paint. I mean, special.
I love watching you and Julian in practice. Yeah. You guys are going at each other.
Got to.
Right? You're making each other better, right?
Got to.
That's what it's all about.
That's exactly what Eli and Keyshawn were doing when we were freshmen. So.
Yeah.
that stuff, you know, you have to do in order to be better.
Yeah. You excited about this season?
Oh, most definitely. I can't wait.
Yeah. This guy will be the point guard for the Colorado Buffaloes as they get that season underway here shortly. There's the point guard, K.J. Simpson, as we're talking with Tad Boyle ahead of the upcoming season. You're number 14 for Tad. You're always going to talk about defense. All right.
Yeah.
Capable team? Willing team to play defense? What do you see?
Absolutely. Great length, the ability to switch, got a lot of versatility defensively on our team. And so, yeah, but the other part of defense is rebounding and finishing possessions. And that's something I think we're going to be capable of as well. And it'll be interesting to see who leads us in rebounding last year. Last year was Javon Hadley, yeah. And I'd like some guys to compete with him. I want our guys to compete with each other. Rebounding the basketball. I want them to be selfish rebounders. I want them to be unselfish players in every other sense of the game. But rebounding the ball, I want some hungry dogs up there.
My vote, by the way, for leading the team in rebounding is Eddie Lampkin, because he's a monster of a human being. He's healthy now for the start of the season. He brings a uniqueness, doesn't he?
He does, yeah. He's still coming back from a back injury. And for 6'11 guys, those are real. So we got to adjust his minutes and not bring him back too quickly. But Eddie brings an edge, a competitiveness, and that might be a good guy to put your money on from a rebounding standpoint, because he will rattle some cages.
You're number 14. Are you as hungry right now as you were 14 years ago?
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm hungrier because I think there's so much more we can do. When I got here 14 years ago, it was like, okay, what can we do with this? But now I know what we can do with it. I know the players we have in the program. I know the ones we're recruiting. I've never felt better about being the head coach here.
Well, the Buffaloes and Tad Boyle open up the season November 6th against Towson. It's just around the corner. Coming up next, we're going to talk women's basketball. J.R. Payne and company, they're excited about their season as well.
I think I say this most years. I love our team, and this year is no different. This is a special group, you know, because we are a very, very veteran-laden group. We have a lot of players that have played a lot of minutes for Colorado basketball and are experienced and hungry and excited and motivated and everything you want a team to be, you know, going into your season. And so, like Seth said, LSU opening night will be an incredible test for us. It's one that we're excited about. And then the rest of the season is also equally challenging. And so it's going to be a great year for us. We're ready.
Back in the Stampede. That was from Media Day, by the way. Look who's here right now. Holy cow. It's all JR all the time. Buffs coming off a Sweet 16 run a year ago. Okay, when you come off a great season like you had a year ago, what does that do for your offseason? Does it raise expectations? Does it reignite you? What does it do for a team?
I think both of those things. Yeah. I think, you know, because we have such a veteran group of those players that had success coming back, elevated expectations in everything that we're doing. You know, we were able to start the season as far as what we know, what we understand, what we're doing a lot higher than usual. You know, normally you start here and you get better as the season goes on. I think we're actually pretty good right now, you know, because we have so many players back.
I would have to think that your off-season workouts, because they got a taste of it and they want more of it, were probably very motivated type workouts, I would think.
Very motivated. Last year, you know, last summer we took our team to Spain. So a lot of what we did in the summer was like team focused. This summer we really took an opportunity to prioritize individual development. So I think players love that when they can just pour into, I need to get better at A, B, and C. You need to get better at X, Y, and Z, and just be able to do that. So I think our players' individual skill sets have grown collectively. Everybody's back, so it makes for a pretty good team.
And I guess what you said just a moment ago about how everyone knows what this team is all about. Over my career, I've talked with coaches and a very veterans team. That changes the way you approach it, because you don't have to explain everything to this group, right? Everyone knows.
Correct. However, we have kind of an interesting balance on this year's team. So we have a lot of veterans, upperclassmen, know what they're doing, and then we have a lot of freshmen, you know, that don't know what they're doing yet. Right. They will in time. You know, so really working to balance, like going fast enough, but not going so fast that we lose people, you know, on the back end. So I think our veterans are doing a great job of coaching up the younger ones. Ultimately, we need everybody on the same page going in the same direction.
You've been recruiting at a very high level here recently, but a Sweet 16 run, what does that help you a little bit?
Yeah, I definitely think it helps. You know, people ask me a lot, does Coach Prime being here help? Yeah. I would say like the notoriety and the vision of the program helps, but definitely winning will make anybody more excited.
Yeah, everyone loves a winner, by the way. And one of the great winners in this team is Jalen Schrod, point guard. Let's hear from her. All right, Sweet 16 a year ago. What was your offseason like a little bit? That kind of raises expectations when you guys do that, right?
Yeah, I think this offseason was just one where everybody pretty much got what they needed. It was, when you have a veteran team, you know, it's kind of easy to know what you need to do, what you need as an individual when you had that maturity level to know your own body and your own physical and mental and emotional needs. So I think everybody came back just with a sense of just like, let's just go get it. It wasn't like a pressure type situation. We already knew, you know, we were bringing everybody back. So it wasn't pressure in the sense of trying to gain that team chemistry more so than just trying to, you know, build off of last year.
Yeah. So, Jay, when you do something like that, does that make a team even hungrier because you want to go deeper?
Yeah, I think we were all disappointed after that Iowa game, and we all knew, like, even in Washington, I got the chance to go to the Final Four and see the national championship game live.
You want a taste of that, right?
Yeah, it puts another chip on the shoulder, and it kind of leaves a bad taste in your mouth. So I would say, yeah, it just got us hungrier for another opportunity.
You've been around a long time. You got Quay, who's a veteran. You got Frieda, who's a veteran. I mean, go on down the line. There's a lot of returning players who played a lot of minutes. Mm-hmm. I would think from a camp standpoint, you guys can kind of jump ahead a little bit and then coach up those young players. But that affords you the ability to kind of move this thing ahead quicker, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, when you don't have to redo, you know, offensive philosophies and defensive philosophies so much with so many people, it does make your job easier. I think coming into it, you know, we did see that gap between, you know, your transfers and freshmen and mm-hmm. the people who've been here for so long. But I think we were very intentional of bridging that gap and bringing them along, so.
How are you better right now, coming back now for a fifth year? How are you a better player?
I feel like a lot of people think it would be basketball-wise, but I'll say, like, just as a person, I feel like I've grown a lot these past couple months. And just, you know, taking life one day at a time and being present in every opportunity has just been something that's really helped me just take it day to day.
Great expectations for the CU women's basketball team, and Jalen Girard's going to be running the show this season. Now, she's a fifth-year point guard, which is a great thing to have as we continue with J.R. Payne, head coach of the Buffaloes. There's a comfort that comes with knowing that your quarterback out there has seen it all, done it all.
It does. I mean, we have two very veteran point guards, and Jalen Sherrod, who's been here now for 5 years, and Kendall Weta, who's been here for three. I feel very confident we have one of the best point guard duos in the country. Kennedy Sanders is a freshman point guard who also is very talented, so we're good at the point guard position.
So the Buffs come off a great season, so you might as well play a top-level schedule. And you don't wade into this season at all, facing the national champion, LSU, to kick things off, and it doesn't really lighten up a whole lot after that.
Right, yeah. I mean, we were really excited about the opportunity. It's not very often that we have an opportunity at a team like LSU, you know, SEC versus Pac-12. So really cool opportunity in Las Vegas. T-Mobile Arena is going to be great. And then we have, I think, three or four more Power 5 teams that we're going to play. So it's a great preseason schedule. I think it prepares us for the Pac-12. I think the Pac-12 is going to be the best it's ever been.
You try to schedule to your team, obviously, with a veteran team, with what you have coming back. Yeah. When you and T sat down and kind of worked on this schedule here, I'd imagine that was front of your mind.
Definitely, yeah. I mean, some years you want to schedule a little bit lighter and sort of ramp up as the season goes on. I think with this many players back, why not just jump right in? We think we're capable of having a lot of success this year, so we're all in.
You know, when we talk about these veteran players coming back for good reason, but you mentioned the youngsters. Give us a little bit of a sense of what they're all about and how they can contribute on a team like this.
Yeah, so the new players on the team this year, we have two transfers, Maddie and Sarah, both very experienced, very talented, filled a need that we had immediately. Freshmen, we have two redshirt freshmen, so Michaela Johnson, Shelemai Sanders, both were here in the middle of last year. So they're have a little bit more knowledge than the other freshmen. And then we have four other freshmen. So Kennedy Sanders, point guard. Lele is a athletic wing from California. Ruthie is a great post player from Nebraska. And then we have Jay Natchison from Dallas. All good, all capable, just young still.
We are going to have so much fun on the hardwood this season between Jerry's team and Tad's team. It's going to be a great year of basketball. That'll put a wrap this week at the Buffalo Stampede. I'm voice of the bus, Mark Johnson. We'll talk to you next time.